as we get ready for the Summer Olympics 2012, starting on the 27th, Friday, this Friday of July. What we're doing is we're making inquiry into unconditional love, which is the sovereign remedy for existence, for the problems of existence, for all of it, for the scenario of loss that existence is. Everything being impermanent, everything being lost is the sovereign remedy. So what I have found is that it's possible to inquire into unconditional love. It's possible. I'm doing it. Very surprising. It's like you inquire and then you suddenly realize you've done something you've never done before, and you've seen something you've never seen before, and you realize, wow, it's possible that my problems can truly be solved. So it's all important, and this is a prep, part of the prep pack for the Olympics, where you have to get some momentum going into the Olympics so you can sidestep them. Don't have to get into it. Don't have to pay attention to it. It's a big to-do, for sure. The reason why we sidestep things, big world events, etc., is because we can't do it all. You cannot do an intense inquiry into unconditional love and at the same time be involved in all these world events and etc. Cannot do it all. Something is going to suffer. So it's very important to have enough momentum built up that you feel that you can just plow right through and not worry about it. You say, I'm paying attention to something more important, way more important. And who knows what's going to happen during the Olympics. It's kind of been a weird build-up to it, I tell you, that is for sure. So inquiry into unconditional love. And this is a beautiful evening. Let's listen to this evening. There's a crescent moon. There is a gorgeous evening sky, soft twilight, with little beautiful sunset with puffy little white clouds everywhere. The crickets and the frogs are joining in. And it's just, the air is completely still. It's a warm evening. And it's just incredible. Let's listen to it. So, what we do on these videos is inquiry, and we show that it's possible to inquire deeper than we're used to making inquiry. What I've noticed in the world is people either A, don't do any inquiry at all, or B, do very shallow inquiry. They're nervous, they're afraid, they kind of go to the teacher and say, how much inquiry do I need to do? And then they do as little as possible. They say, teacher, how safe is it? You know, and say, okay, I'll do a little bit of inquiry. How do you feel? Well, I kind of feel a little nervous and kind of feeling, you know, my attention's not, it's a little bit fragmented and kind of worried about the future, you know. Okay, that's not really inquiry. How do you feel? What's going on? Right. Real inquiry is a rarity. That's not to say that being a rarity, that doesn't mean that it's somehow some sort of irregularity or irrelevancy or something. No, it's just the opposite. It's non-inquiry, which is the irrelevancy, because by doing non-inquiry, we fail to realize that the world is absolutely nothing. It's meaningless. Loss is meaningless. There's no loss in reality. There's no loss in unconditional love. Now, being that there's no loss in unconditional love at all, it's a loss-free experience, how much maintenance work do we need to do? How much maintenance work? Okay, now, when I go out in my yard here, And I've done a lot of garden work. What do I see? Well, what I'm looking for is those things that are not doing well. Does everything have enough water? Is something not looking good? Is there some dead leaves here, dead branches? Always looking to see, you know, what might be in harm that I need to, you know, pay attention to. So I don't really enjoy it that much. I can't just come out and just look at everything and say, oh, it's wonderful, and just ignore all the stuff that's dying. You know, I got to look first for the stuff that's having trouble. But in unconditional love, we don't need to do that. So we don't need to have that type of attention that we have for this world. This world, we're always looking out for what's wrong. What needs fixing? What needs fixing? What needs fixing? You know, some of us who have the money to pay others and have an entitlement complex don't worry about that. What they do is, like, they go out in the garden and they'll say, oh, how beautiful the garden is. I just love, look at that, the flowers, the colors, oh. And they're just, you know, gushing about how great it is. And of course, you know, the people that have to maintain everything, they look at the garden and say, gosh, I hope none of the drip system is clogged. And, oh man, look at that, that's got iron and deficiency. I gotta give it some fertilizer. And look at the weeds over there. I gotta get those weeds out of there. And this one, it's growing too fast. I gotta trim this one. Look at those, you know, this one's some dead there. What's wrong with this one? And how come it's not this? The fruit is not setting. And, you know, on and on and on. Oh my gosh, the birds are getting this fruit. And, oh, there's a gopher over there. You know, the deer just ate this stuff. And, you know, nothing but problems. Okay, nothing but problems. The entitlement class, of course they're going to say, oh, how lovely. Because they're just going to overlook all the problems. Why? Because it's not their problem. They don't see any problems. Because it's entitlement. We don't have to fix problems. We don't have any problems to fix, so why should even look at it? So they're just looking for the whatever they see that's nice. Not worried about any of the rest of stuff. Someone else will take care of all the rest of the stuff. Okay. So the attitude of maintenance is not needed in unconditional love. Because there's nothing to be maintained. Because unconditional love is not a process. It's one effect. Process-free effect. It's not increasing. It's not decreasing. Well, it could be expanding, but it's boundless. It's already boundless. It's already boundless. It's already equally distributed. Equally overlaid. Perfectly tranquil, gentle, limpid, not moving, not changing. Exactly the same quality always from the beginning, very beginning, for eternity. So there's no decay, no sickness, no gophers, no anything to eat. There's nothing to break. There's nothing to... It's a seamless, one seamless effect. Cannot be fragmented, broken. Nothing can happen to it. So there's zero maintenance. Ever, never any maintenance. So this whole attitude of looking for sickness, disease, suffering, all stuff that needs to be maintained, whatever it is, fertilizer. We don't need to fertilize unconditional love. We don't need to water it. We don't need to mow it. We don't need to put a fence around it. We don't have to put a security system there. We don't have to pay for all that stuff. We don't have now. We don't have to wait also for a beautiful day. Tonight was a beautiful sunset. Glorious evening. Wow. And I said, I've been waiting for a long time to see such a glorious evening. Other times, you know, the wind and the rain and the fog and everything, it's not so nice. The cold, excessive heat. And unconditional love, we don't have to worry about what the weather is. There's only unconditional love. There is no weather to it. It's not changing. What you see is what you're getting, always. So we don't have to worry about what the weather is. Or, you know, here in the world, we fight over trying to get to live in the best places. Get the most money, get the most good fortune, so we can live in a house on the cliff of the Pacific Ocean or something. And in eternal, unconditional love, Everywhere is equal, exactly the same experience. So we don't have no competition for place. In unconditional love, the quality is the same everywhere. So there's no battle for status at all. It's all free. There's no battle for money either. So there's no need for competition in unconditional love. Jesus said the greatest of all is love. And he means unconditional love. Doesn't mean agape. Doesn't mean impersonal or affection between people. No. That's not what's talked about. And Buddha had a disciple. What's his name? I'm not sure. It's his principal companion. And I think Buddha told him, you must have love. If you've not realize love, you know, you haven't realized anything. The great teachers know that this unconditional love is the remedy. And it doesn't matter what else you have done. If you don't have that, you don't have anything, really. That is true. That is very true. So it's all important to inquire into this unconditional love. And just, which is what we're doing. Okay, I said status. No status there. All have equal status. All have equal access. It's the same. It feels the same to whoever experiences it. It's the same. So there's no need to compete for money, power, prestige, status, position, all that stuff. Zero need for any of that. You can relax all of that type of vigorous competitiveness and sharpness, you know. And now, of course, I said the entitlement people, they look at, you know, everything in the world seems so beautiful because they don't have to worry about the, you know, problem. Someone else will take care of it. In unconditional love, they have to relax that attitude because there's nobody there that will take care of anything. You don't need any servants there. Because it's all available equally to everyone. And there's nothing wrong with it. It's flawless. So what do you need a servant for? There's nothing to be fixed. There's nothing breaks there. Nothing gets run down. There's no house on a hill there. It's all equal. Perfect equality. Unconditional love gives equally to all. We don't have to manage anything or be managed by anyone. We don't have to earn it. It's just already there for us. Now the management thing is we all are trying to manage our lives here. But in unconditional love, it's always there for us, exactly the same, perfectly, flawlessly there for us. And there's no need to manage anything. It's always going to be there for us. Can never go away. Could never diminish. Can never be harmed. Nothing to manage. Nothing to manage. Nothing to fix, nothing to manage. Nothing can be lost, we can't lose it. Can't be diminished. There's nothing we can do that is going to upset it. Which is very important. It's there equally for all already. All conditions, times, places, situations. It's already there overlaying it all. And it makes no judgment at all. Because its whole purpose is to not change. So if it made a judgment, it would change. It doesn't change. It's not modified. So we don't have to worry like about, am I good enough for it? Or will I say something that'll upset it or something? It cannot be upset. Cannot be upset. And we don't need to complete it. It's already there. It's already boundless. We don't need to play any role. What role do we need to play for it? To get its applause? No, its quality is there for us. Always. We don't need to get its applause. We don't need to tell jokes, get it to laugh. It's always this incredible, still, quiet, limpid tranquility, and radiantly calm, peaceful, present, boundless, gentle, 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 unselfconscious, unconcerned, totally stable. Nothing we can do can change that. So we don't need to worry about being PC, you know. With unconditional love, you don't have to worry. There's no PC-ness necessary. And since there's no PC-ness necessary, we don't even need any thoughts at all, because it doesn't matter what we think. See, what we think doesn't matter to unconditional love. So really, we don't even need to worry about our thinking at all. It's not like we have to get rid of our thinking. No, 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 no. You see, most of the teaching in this world has got it backwards. You don't get rid of anything. You just see that it's irrelevant. It's not necessary anymore. But doesn't change anything one way or the other. So it's almost like you just ignore it. And you think, my thoughts? What are my thoughts? My thoughts don't influence unconditional love one way or the other. Negative thoughts, positive thoughts, whatever, makes no difference, no difference. And since it's everywhere, why do I need to be concerned about where I am, or being somewhere, or not being somewhere? Why do I even need to think of myself as a point, a somewhere? Why do I even need the personality? It all just kind of melts away out of just realizing it's completely unnecessary. Just ignore it. I mean, it's all still there. I imagine it's still there. The body, everything's still there. Personality, the thoughts, everything, but just completely ignored. Just because that you see has no relevance, doesn't affect anything at all. These are inquiries into unconditional love, and I really feel that this is a proper step, really looking at it. It's there to be seen, to be looked at. It doesn't bother, nothing bothers it. It's not taking account of what we've done in existence, all the loss that we've been part of. Makes no judgments at all upon us, upon anything. And so what judgments do we need to maintain? Other than simple, the judgments that simply navigate us through life. Driving a car, for instance. But like I said, you simply let go of what you see is completely useless. But if something is useful, you don't let go of it. Doesn't change unconditional love. You know, we need to drive, we need to function. That's fine. But we will find that there's just this deep, vast domain of judgment and concern and attention, all this stuff. Personal identity and time and space and all this stuff is simply very, very irrelevant, because it doesn't have any bearing on the experience that we're having. You know, like I said, we don't need to maintain unconditional love. It's there forever. It's an effect of an idea. Effects can never leave an idea. And the idea of not trying to change what we are, that idea can remain with us forever as a blessing. We don't need to construct anything. We don't need to build anything. It's already what we're experiencing is perfect just as it is. We don't need to add anything onto it. We don't need to destruct anything. In fact, we cannot. Nothing there to be destroyed. You cannot harm unconditional love at all in any way. You can't do anything to it. So the whole idea of constructivity and destructivity drops away. If you see someone like Ramana Maharshi, you look at them, it seems like everything has dropped away. I mean, you can still function fine, but everything else has dropped away. And you wonder, how did he get rid of all that? Well, simply through disinterest. Simply because it's has no value at all as far as experiencing unconditional love. It's not necessary. It's not useful in any way. So it's just ignored. Not paid any attention to. It's like a watch. We wear a watch. If we need to know what time it is, we look at our watch. But most of the time, we're not aware of our watch. We're not paying any attention to the watch. Personality would be like just a watch, where if we need to go somewhere, we'll go somewhere. But other than that, we're not paying any attention to it. It has nothing to add. Cannot subtract anything. Cannot add anything. Nothing can. Nothing can be added or subtracted from unconditional love. So it's like this great kind of releasing of effort, effortfulness, concern, releasing of concern, worry, doubts, fears, concerns of all different types. The whole complex. The crescent moon is orange up there, beautiful. The whole complex of concern, it just seems to sort of melt down. We're not holding on to it anymore. Letting go of this, let it go. Because it has no relevance whatsoever. And we don't have to act a certain way to keep it, to keep unconditional love. There are no rules, no requirements, no conditions. And therefore we kind of forget about the whole rigid, you know, what do I have to do thing? What do I have to be? Doesn't seem to make any difference. And so it's almost like the whole personality complex dissolves through indifference and irrelevancy. It relaxes. Just an extreme relaxing of all that complex, the tautness of all that complex. We don't need any intermediaries for it. It's there equally at all times for everyone. Always. So who could be an intermediary? We don't have to see it first in the world. The world of loss, it's not in the world of loss. You can't see it there. We're told that there's in the world there's love in the world. So we're trying to master love in the world. We want to be, you know, understand love in the world, etc. Don't need that either. That's a scam. That's an egoic scam of trying to find love, external love in the world. That's not unconditional love. And we think we need to get really, really good at it. You know, we need to have great relationships and learn how to love everyone, etc. No, we don't need any of that. There's no learning involved. It's already there. Not asking any learning of us. It's just there. No conditions. Unconditional love. No conditions. And it's the quality it has is not, cannot be found in the world of loss, because the quality is losslessness, no loss, no change, no loss. That's its quality. You can never find that in this world. It's futile. We're not getting closer to love in this world. No one is. That's an illusion. By realizing we're not making any progress towards it, and never will, it takes an enormous burden off our shoulders. It's right there for us, right here, right now. Same as it's always been. And there's no progress we can ever make towards it. And this is one of the realizations. I'm just feeling this is a tremendous realization. Nobody can make any progress towards it whatsoever. So we can let go of those desperate efforts we're making. We're told that love is something we can make progress towards, and we have to. And how many knots have we tied ourselves into trying to get closer to love? Terrible. So many complexes get built up. But if we find out, you can't make even one step towards it. You can't take one step in the realm of loss towards unconditional love. You cannot take any step towards it. Then it's like you just, oh, all I can do is just experience it then. I can't make any progress towards it, so I experiencing it is all there is to it. That's true. No one brings a resume in. Or what, a resume of progress? There is no way to progress towards it. What we do is we just fail and fail and fail and fail until we finally recognize that we can't make any progress. And then that's when we give up. You know, the great teachers say, give up the search. Punjaji said that, give up the search, give up the search. Give up the search. You're not finding anything. You're not making any progress at all. Nobody is. So, call off the search. Searching for love. What's that song? Searching for love in all the wrong places. Yeah, external world is all the wrong places. Searching for it at all is crazy because it's everywhere. How can you find what is everywhere if you're searching for it? When you search for it, it means it must not be where you are. Why else would you be searching for it? So immediately, the search implies that it's not unconditional love that you're searching for. You're denying it. Searching for it is a denial of it. Because it's saying, well, it's not here. Unconditional love is everywhere. There's no place where it's not. So call off the search means give up your attempt to find it. And then you'll realize it's with you. It's always been with you. So, inquiry into unconditional love is at the root of satsang, really. It is at the root. It's not done so much. We need to try more and more. Need to succeed. Need to really succeed. And it won't necessarily succeed, you know, immediately. Because we still have all these complexes and we wonder, how can we relax all these complexes? Wow. Seems like a tremendous dissolution of, you know, of what we are. Well, what we really are is we built up all these complexes. desperate complex is trying to find love. We all want to find it, and the ego has just had us jumping through hoops and just causes, ties us in knots, and we just got all these massive complexes, and we just, you know, brutalized by them. And we think somehow we need to fix these complexes or something. No, we don't need to fix them. We don't need to treat them. We don't need to do anything with them. They will automatically dissolve into irrelevancy and relax and not become complexes anymore. There's no tension in them at all, none. And we'll just laugh through all of them, shine through all those complexes. We don't have to destroy them, tear them apart, fix them, heal them, do anything. Just this total relaxation of all the complexes, which can only come by experiencing unconditional love. That is the true remedy, sovereign remedy. And, you know, we don't need to be healers there. There's nothing to heal. And there's no sickness there. There's nothing to treat. Unconditional love doesn't need to be treated. Doesn't need any pills. Doesn't need any shots. Doesn't need any tests. Doesn't need any hospital. Doesn't need to be protected. Doesn't need to be defended. Doesn't need to be romanced. You don't have to feel special. It's there for you, for everyone equally. Don't have to worry about its future. Don't have to worry about your future anymore, because your unconditional love will stay with you always. So where's the worry about your future? All these worldly complexes that are built up through loss, this dream of loss, all these complexes subside, relax. And that's what we have to look forward to. That's the real pearl of great price. We simply need to give up the search and allow this melting, relaxing to take place. We cannot artificially get it through body work, you know, relaxing our body, relaxing ourselves, etc. Trying to relax our complexes, thinking that in doing so that will bring us closer. No, it does not. It makes us think that there's something we need to do first, because it won't relax it enough, maybe. No, it whatever your condition, makes no difference to unconditional love. It will relax your condition. Guaranteed. Your sickness? There's no sickness there. There's no reason to be sick. What does sickness get you? Nothing. Whether you're sick or well, doesn't make any difference. So the whole issue of sickness or wellness, again, recedes as well. Bodily concerns recede. You realize that the body of unconditional love is boundless and invulnerable. And that's what you're experiencing. Even fear of death recedes, because you know what you're experiencing can't die. So, how could there be any death of what you want? What you want can't die. So what is death? Nothing. Just a bluff. And all this may sound very profound. It is, but it's simply inquiry turned in the right direction. It's not difficult. You just have to have the will and clarity to say, okay, I'm going to put inquiry directly to unconditional love. It doesn't mind. Nothing bothers it. Nothing inconvenienced it. How could it be inconvenienced? It remains as it is. Nothing changes it, so how could it be inconvenienced? It has no specific goal or purpose or anything. It's already overlaid everything. It's equally, simultaneously. It's just there. That is its purpose, to be there. To be as it is. That is its purpose. It's fulfilling its purpose. Its purpose is fulfilled. Every moment its purpose is perfectly fulfilled. It simply remains as it is. So it's not struggling with anything, reaching any goal. That's why it's limpid, tranquility, gentle, soft. Not struggling. No internal conflict, no conflict. Peace beyond understanding. As the world, external world, goes through all its gyrations of loss, and our complexes tighten up as they will, we really need to experience unconditional love. Because the world is tightening up our complexes very badly. It's getting tough for some people, you know, in a lot of ways, and will get tougher and tougher. It's like they're filling our backpacks with water, and it's getting very heavy, filling it with lead. All this baggage that we're carrying around, trying to qualify for unconditional love, gets getting heavier and heavier and heavier because we see the world the way it's changing. We're feeling like, wow, it's getting steeper and steeper, the path. And it's harder and harder to qualify. That's what we feel. But then we find out we're all pre-qualified. Set the baggage down. We can be as light as a feather. We can be unburdened with our concerns. This is the great goal of the spiritual inquiry. And to realize again that we can't make any progress might be the most powerful realization of all. If we could meditate on that, it's impossible to make any progress towards unconditional love. No progress is possible towards that. Then we end the struggle to get there. We don't realize we're already there because we're trying to get there. And trying to get there is what piles all these complexes on us. It's already there for us, and it's right here, right now. Don't need to do anything. Get anywhere. We can't do anything to qualify. We can't make any progress. Already pre-qualified. It's already here. These are spiritual platitudes, but very important ones to continually consider. Because we're not going to succeed any other way except to finally, call off the search. Finally give up trying to succeed at it, trying to progress towards it. Some say they call it surrender or submission. Somehow you let go, you finally let go of your efforts. And just give up, so to speak. Give up the futility. And then you find that it's already there. It's always been there for you. no matter how long we've been hearing this, we truly have to actually focus on it more now than we have in the past. Bring it home. Because the external, the last external play is going to become, again, very weird. It's going to tighten up our complexes. It's going to actually make us feel so enmeshed in complexity that many of us are just not going to be able to function anymore. People are going to go nuts. Start freaking out. Enmeshment in complexity to the point where people just, they don't feel like they can move at all. They don't feel, they feel pinned down, hedged in, like in a cage. So what we need to do is relax all those complexes, relax the complexity. There is no complexity in unconditional love, none, zero. It's the same everywhere. And it doesn't change. Where's the complexity? There's no need to maintain it. Nothing you need to do. Nothing anything anyone needs to do. Where's the complexity? It will always be there. You can never do anything to harm it or disqualify yourself. Where's the complexity? It's making no judgments on you. Doesn't matter what the personality is or what complex you've had. Where's the complexity? It's complexity-free, complex-free. We've built up all these complexes, assuming we need to do that in order to somehow get it. But that's those complexes only gotten in our way. And even though they're in our way, they still don't prevent us from getting it. We just have to relax. There has to be some relaxing of the effort, some realization, deep realization, not a external relaxing, trying to impose relaxation, but some kind of like aha, a moment where we drop the effort, as it were. We say, okay, I'm for a moment, I'm going to just stop searching. For a moment, I'm not going to worry about what my thoughts are. Well, I'm not going to even try to stop thoughts or anything. For a moment, I'm just going to... You cannot manufacture this moment. You cannot manufacture... All we can do is inquire, keep inquiry, and at some point we will realize and drop the effort. Just not get rid of the efforts, but just realize we don't really have to do anything. And we're at peace with that. There's some feeling, there's an intuitive move of I don't need to do anything. And I never can do anything that will change this at all, my situation at all. Nothing I can do that will ever change my situation, because I'm unconditional love is always present with me. That can never change. There's nothing I need to do to qualify. I'm already pre-qualified, so everything is already done. Unconditional love is there. I'm pre-qualified. There's no way I can disqualify myself. Nothing I need to do to experience it. Nothing I need to do first. No process, nothing. I can't make any progress towards it. And my situation is set. It's always the same. It'll always be the same. You see, this inquiry brings it into the realm now of choice. Of options. You see, wow, if you see this is how it is, what have I got to lose? You know, It's that sense of, what have I got to lose? The more you realize you got nothing to lose, you lose your fear. You got nothing to lose except irrational fear. And we can do it. We can get there. We have to get there. And we need to intensify this inquiry. Get it, you know, clearer and clearer and clearer. It can be done. Absolutely, it will be done. All the inquiry is to get us to the point where we realize we don't need to do anything. And our situation is, no change can ever come to our situation other than choosing unconditional love. But I mean, we can't make any progress towards it. We can't make any progress away from it. We're basically just jogging in place, you know, not doing anything, not going anywhere. That will always be the case. And then when we realize that, the complexes begin to relax. And we just let them relax. We don't need to figure out how they're relaxing, because we're not trying to come up with some new therapy. No, inquiry is the therapy. We're already doing it. We already know how to do it. This is the ultimate therapy. The relaxation is automatic. It's a given. It will simply just happen out of irrelevancy. But that irrelevancy is only there because unconditional love is being experienced. That's the only true therapy there really is. It's the only true therapy. It's the presence of unconditional love bringing the irrelevancy to all these complexes. And this irrelevancy just relaxes them all automatically. You don't have to write a textbook on this. You don't have to try and figure it out. It's irrelevant. That's what it is. That is the figuring out. And whatever the relaxing, however it goes, that's how it's going to go. It doesn't matter. There's no right way or wrong way for it to relax. It will simply relax as the irrelevancy works has its effect on it. You just feel it. Oh, you realize this unconditional love. Oh, I'm experiencing it in this. I don't need to experience something else. And since I'm already experiencing it and it's not going away, I don't need to work on some kind of way to keep it, to qualify for it and keep it for a while. It's not trying to run away. It's not trying to escape from me. It's not trying to do anything. I'm just here. So I don't need to go try and get some more credits for it. Love, unconditional love credits, like carbon credits. I need to go earn some more credits so I can, you know, put them in the jukebox. Unconditional love is not a jukebox where you put your money in and hit the song and it plays and then you got to put more money in. It's not a jukebox. It's always there. And we need trust. We need to know that this is true. Otherwise, we might experience the relaxing of our complexes as threatening. Because our complexes are designed to get us some tokens to put in the jukebox. And we think the more tokens we have, the more unconditional love we're going to be able to experience. But we need these complexes to drive ourselves to get these tokens. So we got all these tokens and we feel this, we put them in the jukebox and we feel this relaxation of our complexes. We say, whoa, 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 I won't be able to acquire no more tokens, so when it runs out, I'll really feel bad. Unconditional love, it doesn't run out. It doesn't disappear. It doesn't diminish. It doesn't throw up requirements of us. It doesn't put conditions on our experiencing. So if we can trust that, if we prepare like this, we're not progressing towards it, but we are preparing for it. That's different. We're sort of intuitively looking at what would be the dynamic that arises and what might cause us to get nervous about it, because again, our complex is being relaxed. We feel like our whole means to get something is being relaxed. And that might feel very threatening to some if they don't see the wide context of the situation. Because we think that love is something we have to get. It's the prize for those who are best at getting. And here we feel all our getting simply dissolving. All our taught complexes that designed to get are being relaxed into just limpidness, you know, just tranquility. So we think, oh my gosh, how am I going to be able to get anything? Well, what else do we need to get? The feeling will be we don't need to get anything else. This is it. It's already here. What we want is here. And that we don't need, it's going to be always here. We don't need to keep paying the bills. Unconditional love is not a utility company. You know, it's not going to send us bills. It's not like we're getting on credit. We have to pay back the credit card. It's not like a credit card company either. It's not a business. So all those fears, you know, will melt away. There's so many fears. It's incredible. And some of the sadhana that's done by the true sadhana is simply this melting away of all these complexes, and the one just, we just stay in observance, just sort of disinterestedly observing this and just noticing that there's all these complexes are just gradually unloosening and getting freed of their tension, loosening up, widening up, becoming very untense and uncomplex, very simple, and being reduced to utter simplicity. And we just, you know, notice it. Don't have to do anything about it. It just takes place automatically. So we don't have to bring with us all our therapy, our therapist's mind, do we? Because it's going to happen automatically. Guaranteed. So if we literally are burden-free, we don't have to go in there with all these smarts, the therapists, like, I'm going to need to help out, so I have to know all these therapeutic moves to make and psychological capacities. Because I'm going to have to help this process along. And how am I going to be able to get through it by, you know, understanding everything that's going on and everything. Now, you don't need to understand what's going on. It happens automatically. We don't need to know anything about guilt, projection, rejection, defense mechanisms, reaction formations, fragmentations, all these various, you know, how to see through that, or this or that, or how to manage this or that, or don't need any of that. It'll automatically relax. Don't need any degrees in anything. That therapist mentality. You're not going to be suffering. These complexes will be relaxing on their own, automatically being relaxed, and you're not even doing it. This unconditional love is bringing it about simply because of what it is. The irrelevancy of this other complex is simply there. The irrelevancy is seen, it is felt, it is simply relaxed because it's irrelevant. That is part of the whole situation. So automatic therapy takes place. You don't have to even pay attention to it. And you might think that you need to catalog all this therapy so you can become a great therapist. But you realize that, no, it's unconditional love that's the great therapist. And what you need to do is simply allow this relaxing to happen and then witness to this to others. And they will then, you know, have more assurance because you're witnessing. And then they'll do that and just let it happen on its own. So you don't become some great therapist as far as technique goes. You realize there's no need for any therapist. And so you get out of the way. As a therapist, you are out of the way. You are all relaxed. Your complexes are relaxed. You're abiding in unconditional love. And you say, come on in, the water's fine. That's it. And people will say, yeah, but how do I do this? How do I relax this complex? How do I relax this? Don't worry. There is no how to it. It's simply that it's the irrelevancy of these complexes automatically relaxes them. We're permeated, saturated with the irrelevancy of it. It's perfectly apparent. It's immediately, totally apparent. And that's just, we're saturated with this, and that automatically, the complexes just relax into that. Automatically, without us doing anything about it. And we're seeing this through inquiry. Inquiry is a way of seeing. It's not experiencing, though. It's a way of seeing. But there's a saying, look before you leap. Not that, you know, that there's anything wrong. The pool is full. There's no rocks in the pool. You know, just gently get in the pool. The water is full of the gentle water. But we're so freaked out about it that we need to look carefully in the pool just to make sure, is everything okay. And so inquiry is just looking at, you know, the pool of water very carefully until we get to the point where we realize, you know, yeah, it's all okay, no worries, no problem. Again, we're not changing anything in the pool, we're just sitting there checking it out. And the idea of inquiry is eventually there's enough reassurance, there's enough seeing a situation as it is that there's nowhere to go anyway. We're always sitting on the edge of the pool. Might as well look at the pool. You know, we're not going anywhere. We can sit at the edge of a pool and dream that we're going somewhere, but we're not. We cannot distance ourselves from unconditional love. It's impossible. It's wherever we are, it's right there. So we might as well look at it. It's just intelligent to do it, right? do some more of it. I feel like there's more that can be done. Occasionally, someone will simply, you know, be enough reassured enough, and they will even let go of inquiry. Now, here's the thing. The experience of unconditional love is the end of inquiry. And maybe the final step is to let go of inquiry itself. Because inquiry has been like a great crutch to, a great tool, mechanism to look, to make sure it's all safe. And that once we see it's all safe, what do we need the inquiry for anymore? So I'd say the final step is to lay down your inquiry. To lay it down. But you have to do it first before you can lay it down. Inquiry is extremely helpful. But you don't want to short circuit by just saying, oh, okay, I can do it just by laying it down without having ever done any, because your fear will probably still be there because your eyes are closed. And, you know, inquiry is just like opening your eyes and seeing what's there and seeing, ah, this pool of unconditional love is there. I can just get in this pool. And it's safe, everything's fine. But once you see it, then inquiry, you don't need to keep making inquiry forever. Enough is enough. Once it's been seen, then drop the path of inquiry. It's then. And some have done that. They've dropped the path of inquiry. And let everything relax, all their complexes relax. And it is more of a relaxing. There's technically everything is still, I mean, the persona is still there. It's a very relaxed persona. Everything is still there, just very relaxed in terms of complexity. There's no complexity. There's no appeal to complexity anymore. No need for it. It's irrelevant. So the mind becomes very relaxed, very, they call it still. It's just because there's no need for any complexity. Unconditional love has no complexity to it. And since we're experiencing what we want, what more do we need? And whatever we need, want to get in the external world, unconditional love stays with us, and we don't need for complexity for that at all. So whatever, however we need to function in the world, if we need to put some complexity to something, that can be done. But then it can also be, after we've done what we need to do, it dissolves, it relaxes back. Just like that. So we don't need to remain as if we're melted into, you know, we can still function when we need to function. And if there's some complexity we need to temporarily utilize, we can do it. And then we let go of that, and quickly, it's back into extremely relaxed condition. Because we know we don't need it to experience unconditional love at all, which is what we really want. So these are some pointers, very helpful pointers. And the more we look at these pointers, the better off we will be. Eventually, you get to the end of inquiry, meaning we reach a point where, okay, more inquiry isn't really going to, you know, bring any change at all. And then we can actually experience this that we've been told. Now, I can speak on this because I trust my teachers. I believe what they've shown me. I believe it's real. I believe it's true. I'm certain of it. And having some glimpses of it, and then using inquiry to see it, able to speak on this, because I just have tremendous, absolute, 100% belief in my teachers, that they're telling me truthfully, really is there. It's not a trick at all. So I've got this, you know, some underlying certainty, even though the complexes are still there, still here, haven't relaxed yet, because the inquiry is still taking place. But I can have this urgency and certainty about inquiry that it is going to lead to the eventual dropping of the inquiry into unconditional love and the relaxing of all complexes automatically. And the burdens will be, you know, dropped away. So, that's what we have to look forward to. And it will be a good time for us to do that. And hopefully, you know, maybe before the Olympics even start. That would be good timing. But we don't want to put a specific time on it. We never know when we suddenly feel that we've done enough inquiry. We never know that when that's going to happen. And we shouldn't put an arbitrary date on it that we're going to do it by this date. That itself builds another complex, right? We don't want to keep piling complexes on ourselves. That being said, there is some urgency. And we don't want that to turn into a complex. If it turns into a complex for you, then drop it. Forget about the urgency. But for some, if they're far along the inquiry, you know, realizing, hey, it's a good time to bring up the intensity of it as much as possible and see if we cannot reach the end of inquiry. You know, see if we can do it. Right now, you know, let's go for it. That's a good thing. If it doesn't build up some complex that you can't handle. If you feel it is, then you need to back off from that a little bit. Don't worry about it. It is possible to build up a complex that's too much. I mean, I do that for myself sometimes. And it just feels like I'm almost dying. The complex becomes so extreme. I just have to, you know, let it go a little bit or make some additional inquiry and get past it. And so we don't want to put too much pressure on needing to reach the end of inquiry, dropping of inquiry by some point. And on the other hand, we don't want to just sit back and think that we don't need to pick up the pace. Because, again, the complexes, the complexity that is going to take place in the world, the complexity will be so severe. And our feeling like trying to deal with it will put us under such a complex. You know, it's just going to drive us into the ground, pull us into the grave. Really, it's going to be so severe. So severe. So really, it's just a word to the wise to go for it. Without going too fast. It's like driving your car fast. Really fast. But not too fast. Not so fast that the whole thing's shaking, you know. You can drive your car push it to its limit and it's still smooth. Everything still feels smooth. But if you push it too far, you start feeling vibration, right? Now, in the modern cars, you can go pretty darn fast without the vibration. It used to be in the older cars, you know, you'd get over like 85 or something and the whole thing would start shaking like it's going to fall apart. It scares the daylights out of you, and then whoo, you back off. Not that I ever did this. Not much. I have been with people that have done that, actually. Pretty scary. I took a modern car up pretty high on a stretch of a freeway that was very completely open for miles, you know. And there's no vibration, but I started getting afraid that there might be a whole bunch of vibration if I go any faster, so backed off of it. Got kind of scary. But, you know, I know someone that used to drive their Mercedes 125. And, you know, it was smooth, still smooth. But even those cars, you get too fast and it does start vibrating. And boy, you have to back off. So same thing. If inquiry is getting too fast, too intense, you have to back off, because you don't want to build up a too much of a complex of pressure. But what you find is you build up a tolerance for it. You realize where your tolerance level is, like how fast can your car go? Can it go 100, 120, 140, so to speak? How intense can your inquiry be? And then you bring it up to that, and maybe go a little faster, a little more, a little more, a little more. Just don't build up that complex. Gotta be careful of it, but at the same time, gotta go fast. Don't hit the brakes too hard. Just keep that speed going. And we've done a lot here in this video, a lot, touched on a lot of things. The final thing was, don't build up a complex to put too much pressure. Before that, it was dropping inquiry is the end of the path. That once you drop your inquiry, then you step into the unconditional love. And you're conscious that, okay, let's move into it. Let's move into experience. Realizing that you don't have to capture any of the relaxation as some kind of process to report to other people. You don't need to make any report like that. You need to only make the report, yeah, all my complexes relaxed. That's the only report that's really needed. And that you feel that you've been unburdened. You're aware that all these complexes which are designed to try and qualify for love and find it and get it and keep it, all of those have, you know, through irrelevancy, have subsided and relaxed to the ultimate extent. You're no longer burdened by those. That you can witness to that and say that, of course. And you know that you have to speak in this all-inclusive way, instead of, you know, saying, trying to pinpoint some little complex and say, well, what exactly happened to this little complex, and how did the process of unraveling or relaxing take place exactly in this little complex, etc. That just builds up another complex. If you follow that line of inquiry, if somebody's asking that, that is just going to build up another total insane complex of believing that you have to somehow pay attention to all that, which is just a nightmare. So you will, as a witnesser to unconditional love, just say, come on in, the water's fine. It will all automatically, softly, gently relax. Automatically, safely, with no freak out at all, because you're aware of the irrelevancy of it, so there's no freak out. Once you're aware of the context of what you're doing, you didn't get shoved in. You stepped in because you knew you're ready for it. This is what you want, and you see, this is what's ahead of me. Okay, let's do it. Again, and before that we said, if we're feeling all these complexes being relaxed to the ultimate extent, and we are still totally deluded as far as what unconditional love really is, we'll feel that we're losing our effort, our ability to maintain it, and that will freak us out. So, you know, those who try to, on a dare, jump into unconditional love, they jump out just as fast. Then they're freaked out. They say, oh my gosh, I felt I was losing myself, meaning my ability to get what I want. When we say ourself, we're losing ourselves. It's the complexes, the abilities, the complexity and capability to get what we think we need and want. We feel we're losing that, not realizing that unconditional love is what we want and need. So, you know, the teachers, the great teachers, you see, they're abiding in it. Those are the ones, the great witnesses to it. They're not freaked out by lack of complexity in it. They're not at all. They just abide in this pure simplicity of it. Look at Ramana, you know, gosh, pure simplicity there. At ease. At ease. Because he understood the total context of this really is what I want. And I am pre-qualified and I don't need to do anything. It's completely simple. And so he abided in it. So abidance in it, those are the teachers. The ones who jump in on a dare and the rabbit, the hares that jump in, jump out, you know. They can't really teach. They only will build up more complexes. Some kind of spiritual complex. All sorts of weird complexes can get built up by various teachers who say, you know, they're teaching that, you know, here, this is simply inquiry from someone who is only doing it from the standpoint of inquiry. Okay, so there's no teacher here of unconditional love, no experiencer of unconditional love, other than just a few brief glimpses, but I understand the context of that, understand the reaction to it. So it's just inquiry, sitting on the edge of the pool, looking, checking everything out carefully. That's all that it is. That's all that it is here. But that's very effective. Okay. Seems a shame to quit. It's such a perfect evening. But we don't want to completely overburden ourselves, so let's wrap this up. And hopefully later on in this day, we will make more efforts, more inquiry. Take a little closer look. There's nothing else really to do, is there? Might as well do it. Okay. Very great. That is it.